community level resilience for water related hazards. Dr. Manisha V. Ramesh is Director and Professor, Center for Wireless Networks and Applications, Dean of International Programs, and the UNESCO Chair in Experiential Learning for Sustainable Innovation and Development at Amrita Vishwavidyapeeth. Dr. Ramesh's research work was instrumental in deploying the first ever wireless sensor network system capable of issuing landslide warnings. She has received a US patent for her work titled Network-Based System for Predicting Landslides and Providing Early Warnings. Her research areas include wireless sensor networks for real-time monitoring of natural disasters such as landslides, avalanches, floods, and droughts, wireless sensor network algorithm design, wearable wireless sensors for healthcare applications, and wireless network design for rural health, among others. Ms. Divya currently serves as research associate at the Amrita Center for Wireless Networks and Application, Amritapuri campus. She made key contributions in designing and developing the decision support system for the landslide monitoring system that is deployed by the center in both Munnar in Kerala and in Sikkim. She has also worked on developing experiments for the remote triggered wireless sensor network lab and in devising algorithms for localization and tracking of fishing vessels as part of the MicroNet project. Ms. Hemalatha is a research associate at the Amrita Center for Wireless Networks and Applications and is currently pursuing a PhD in establishing an automated learning system for monitoring and forecasting rainfall-induced landslides. Her research interests are building automated systems with machine learning and forecasting technologies for real-time monitoring of environmental applications. Historical analysis of natural disasters such as landslides, avalanches, floods, and droughts, and laboratory and numerical modeling of geotechnical and hydrological processes related to landslides. Once again, the three of them will be talking on technologies for building community-level resilience for water-related hazards. Over to the three of you. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Dr. Murali. Due to the time constraint, I think we have decided that we will just one of us will present, even though we prepared together. I think we have a very short time. So as he said, today's presentation is on technologies for building community level resilience for water related hazard. Myself, Manisha, and two of my research scholars, Divya and Hemalatha, has contributed in this work. So here we are looking into the water related disasters. The major thing what we are seeing is climate change is increasing, and that is bringing in an exponential growth of disasters. So there is a complex interactions in the ocean, atmosphere, and land process are cascading together to bring in all these water related disasters, which are resulting to multi-hazards. And what majorly is happening? So if you look at the figure, which is on the right side, you can see the increase of flood over the years from 1980 to 1999 to 2000 to 2019 as 1389 to 3254. This data is from UNDRR. And you can see how the storms have increased, landslide has. So each and every disaster is increasing. And what we are lacking now capturing is the multi-hazard, how one of them is triggering others, and what are the cascading effects which are coming in. So to understand multi-hazard, we lack an in-depth understanding, because we are lacking the interrelationship between the different hazards and its triggers. We are also lacking the spatio-temporal prevalence and its impact. And each of these disasters has contributed at different levels. Like if you look into this particular figures, you can see the total number of disasters reported. The flood is the highest with 41%. And if you see the total number of people died, the highest is earthquake. And the economic loss is the highest is going into storm, whereas the people affected is going into the highest as the flood. So there is a variation between them, and none of these are capturing is there any one of them is a multi-hazard. So the causes of hydroclimatic disasters is, as each one of us knows, there is an extreme climate event such as floods, drought, and tropical cyclones, heavy and prolonged rainfall, depleted rainfall droughts, and also changes in climate that result into changes in mean frequency and or intensity. So This increase in hydro hazard impacts an increased cost for the system, for the community, for the government, or for all the different organizations. These are all attributed to factors such as there is an, you can see an increased event frequency and magnitude. You can see an unplanned urbanization is contributing to it. Degradation of ecosystem services and the livelihoods are becoming more and more vulnerable, and inaccurate public perception of risk. So the challenge is how to identify appropriate and timely adaptation measures in a continuously changing environment. So all these attributes which are causing in a bigger challenge, and the challenge itself is getting more complicated because it is our environment is continuously changing. And to address these things, there are a lot of research gaps that need to be filled. So some of them are, it would require an in-depth understanding of hydrogeomorphological process and its impact on various hazards, appropriate techniques for data collection, integration and analysis, scaling and heterogeneity of issues, ability to forecast the events related to hazards and their interaction and feedbacks with the socio-ecological systems, uncertainty estimation, communication of data, dissemination of information, integration of effective and reliable decision-making models. So let me take one case study here for the water-related disaster, Kerala floods 2018, a case study of multi-hazard. So in 2018, southwest monsoon, there is an extreme rainfall experienced by the state of Kerala in India with a 42% departure from normal and flooding 14% of total land area of Kerala. Landslides more than 200 plus, 36 dams were opened, and there were even changes in river course, leading to a death toll of 450 plus. And all the districts of Kerala became red alert and displaced more than 100,000 people. And it was completely flooded, all states, all the people. So in this multi-hazard, if you look into it, this continuous rainfall in the month of August contributed to the initiation of landslides, floods, collapse of infrastructure, houses, and ruination of agricultural lands. Where do you mark this disaster? Do you mark it as flood? Do you mark it as landslide? Do you mark it as the infrastructure damage? So all these things over the time are getting as one. And this has contributed to the creation of multi-hazard events in almost every state, every district in Kerala. So this spatio-temporal correlation of events of rainfall, flood, landslides, and dam opening has led to multi-hazard scenario, which is combined, where is the union of many hazards in the same location has happened, consequent occurring as a direct result of an event or a situation, subsequent also happened, occurring after one is over, may or may not be related, and simultaneous occurring at the same time. So over that period, we were able to see the transition of from single event to combined or consequent or subsequent or simultaneous to finally to the multi-hazard. So when we look at single event, you can see that the major single event experienced by the state is a heavy rainfall with unexpected rainfall departure. So the table clearly shows that at different periods, the departure was very high. And if you see 9th August 2018 to 19 August 2000, almost 255% of departure from normal in millimeter, you can see. And this has triggered, this single event has triggered multiple hazards. So here we are looking into what are the consequent events happened. So the single event contributed to initiation of several consequent multi-hazards. So heavy rain of more than 2,515 for 80 days has happened to the consequent flood event. And all the dams started filling up. And this has forced the dams to release excess water, leading to an increase in area of flooding. And that has resulted in consequences such as forest collapse, demolition of bridges, roads, houses, ruination of agricultural land, and loss of life. Now, if you see these two figures, the first figure is talking about the Idukki Dam, which is on the higher part of the topography. So where, if you see that, if this is the inflow of the dam is shown in green color, outflow in red color. So you had inflow only up to inflow up to 8, and then on the 9th you are starting the outflow, and slowly you can see there are landslide events shown at different days, and you can also see that water in the reservoir and how the slightly flooded happened in 18th August and 24th August. But a dam which is down in the downstream combined the water releases from multiple dams, and which has caused flooding on the downstream area from the day of 9th August, and when it reached up to 17 or 18, it became almost like simultaneous events happening. So in areas like Wayanad, you can see that they had experienced this heavy rainfall has contributed to rise in water level, riverbank erosion, weakened and weathered geology of terrain that had previous human interventions has led to landslide, land sinking and flood. They experienced combined effect of landslide and flood, and a total of 474 new landslides were reported during this period. And this has also contributed to subsequent multi-hazards, which may be due to those incidents may be due to the anthropogenic activities which was happening, as removal of those sand mining, quarrying of mountains, urbanization of catchment area. And as I earlier said, as the days progressed from the last week of July to 8th August, the disaster event has transitioned from single to consequent to simultaneous events of rainfall, dam opening, landslides and flood. And it has actually contributed to the multi-hazard impacts on the downstream area on a very high level. And it forced the closure of transportation networks such as roads, railways and airports, and simultaneous power shutdown impacting communication network. So as I earlier said, the dams are connected from the dam one, which we were talking about, Idukki. This is how the network goes. And if you see that this area, which is in the high ranges, didn't have much of the flood, whereas on the lower ranges, on the area, there is a flow of excess water which was happening. So if you see, there is a pink color where it shows it is heavily flooded locations, whereas the flood has started from the other end, where because of the network of dams also this has increased. So this torrential rainfall was simultaneous opening of multiple gates of these dams, which covered areas like Aluva, Muattupuzha, and North Palur. And as each of the dam was opening, it increased the coverage of risk by 20 folds. And the network has contributed to the larger flooding scenario. So even though it started as a single event triggered by rainfall, it transferred itself into a simultaneous events leading to multi-hazard. So this image gives you the chronology of multi-hazard events which happened over those days from 9th August to 20th August, how it has moved from single to multi-hazard. So what is happening here? It started as an extreme rainfall. So extreme weather has caused either the dam opening or it has caused the flood or landslide. But then dam opening has created flood and flood has created dam opening and land. So it's so much interrelated. So for us to build a community resilience, it is necessary to have systems which are capable to understand, measure, and monitor all these different parameters so that we are able to escape from the disaster. So that's why earlier in the research gap, it said we need to have an in-depth understanding of the hydrogeomorphological processes and its impact on various hazards. So for that, we used to have sensing using physical sensors. Virtual sensors means from a physical sensor, you derive another sensing parameter or remote sensing measures. But the challenge is we are limited with respect to the designer's knowledge, whoever is designing, and there is a lack of in-depth understanding. So to achieve in-depth understanding, you need multi-parameter sensing, heterogeneous techniques, and machine learning techniques. So we have to build the sensing layer and data acquisition layer to handle these situations. So if you take the case of Kerala flood, you have to measure multiple parameters, like for extreme weather, rainfall, temperature, humidity, flood, you have rainfall, water level, water flow, terrain, landslide, rainfall, moisture, pore pressure, movement, dam opening, water level, pressure, strain, particle settlement. So you have to have a heterogeneous monitoring, and they vary with respect to domain, where the spatial measurement you need, how the temporal variability of measurement, and it span to multiple locations because it's large area it is covering, and how. So you need to learn that interrelationship and connection between those things. But when you try to do such a data acquisition device, you need to develop appropriate techniques for this data collection. So each of these sensing parameter will demand either continuous or periodic measurement of these data. And the data acquisition challenge is becoming the coverage, because how much spatial area you are going to cover and what temporal frequency you need to collect. So each of those data which you connect, you have to have analysis of homogeneous parameters and analysis of heterogeneous parameters, because you may have all the places you want to only look at rainfall, or you may have to combine the rainfall and the flow rate, or rainfall and the pore pressure. So how do you combine them and understand? And all these things, if you have to store in a particular device, the storage becomes constrained. So you will see constraint on these technologies of sensing. When you want to sense more, it will consume more energy. When you want more storage, it will demand more computation. When you have more computation, more energy. When you have to have more transmission of data, also more energy. But the energy is a constrained thing. So when you have a constrained energy, the climatic conditions will make it more constrained. So here Amrita has developed a system which will actually look into data acquisition by understanding the context, and it will be capable to switch off different sensors, change its frequency of collection. So it will cater to the trade-offs, and based on that, it will actually dynamically prioritize which sensor to be data to be collected, schedule them, and then do the communication accordingly. And all these are connected to edge node, which will be generated with respect to which domain you are using, whether it is flood or landslide or whatever it is. Based on that, you are sensing the data acquisition model, the spatial and temporal frequency has to be. But the basic thing is that edge node has to be low cost, it has to have heterogeneous sensing, it has to have heterogeneous real-time wireless connectivity with data analytics and localized warning, power optimization, and fault tolerance. Is that enough? No. Whatever you collect has to be communicated so that we can derive the knowledge from the data received from those. So for that, you will need heterogeneous devices, because all this need to work in a very extreme hostile condition. So heterogeneous devices has to be put in to take care of the fault. And you have to also have different types of devices to cater to the distance between the devices. So the spatial distance and at what transmission frequency you have. So you have to also look into how do you cater to the fault tolerance with respect to extreme climate, power availability, node failures, etc. So this is the network diagram for our landslide system, where we have the site-specific network, which is called the prop network. From there, we have multiple different types of connection, which is connecting to the local field lawn. And from there, we have multiple connections with respect to broadband and also satellite-based connection to send to the central station to do the analysis. With all this data coming in, what is most important is the integration of effective and reliable decision-making models. So there should be an interrelationship of parameters in through either we learn through sensing or through machine learning approaches. And based on that, we have to come up with decision models for individual parameters, the homogeneous parameters, and heterogeneous. So the requirement is identification of primary triggers and dependent parameters. You have to have a spatial temporal variability of parameters and relation between vital parameters. And different methodologies need to be used, like simulation models, threshold models, nowcasting or forecasting algorithms, integrated decision models for multi-parameter data. So this shows what we have done for the landslide system, where we have actually, for our decision model, we have decade-long data, which we do the real-time data analysis, adaptive learning, and intelligent forecasting. We try to study the meteorological, geological, hydrological, and vibrational data. And spatiotemporal analysis through data mining tools and machine learning through models will be used for to derive the threshold models for heterogeneous sensor systems. We have developed also forecast models and rainfall threshold models, and also the forecasting model. So what we have faced is when you have extreme weather, you will lose connectivity. So if you see the data here, you can see the break in the data. So these data, how do I know? Because it is very important, it is disaster. So we have developed machine learning models from the features which we learn from the domain knowledge of landslide, rainfall, and flood. And based on that, we now cast what is the data, and we are able to come up with the blue line, which you are seeing here, which is coming almost at the same line as where we have lost the data. Same way, we use the forecast data, which is giving for the rainfall, which is given by IMD, and use that data to forecast the pore part of pressure and the factor of safety of the hills. And then we actually give the slope stability of the mountain. And this will help the administrators to actually to give the warning ahead of time. So on this forecast, we need to have the ability to forecast triggers and event. That means you have to forecast triggers like rainfall, moisture, pore pressure, and the event like extreme rainfall, antecedent rainfall condition, expected flow rates, dam filling, pore pressure, etc. So for this whole thing, we have come up with a model which will look into monitoring and of the different sources, developing in the thresholds based on context-aware models, regional rainfall thresholds, pore water pressure forecast models, debris flow model, etc., and multi-scale and multi-level early warning system, which is territorial, regional, near site, site specific, and that will be fed for the rescue and relief optimization. So it uses a 4-level warning. And if you see with respect to the color, the first level warning will actually inform the researchers, second goes to government, third goes to media and public. So, and all these things are based on the validation from the field data, landslide laboratory and slope stability. We are able to give those warning, and we have issued warnings in 2009, 11, 13 and 18. And this shows one of the warnings which we have. Even the recent 2020 warning of Rajamalai, where more than 80 people have died, has been warned to the Kerala state disaster management aspect. So, but more than this, the major factor is how do you disseminate the knowledge, what you have gained, and it is really important that you transfer regularly in real time to policymakers, researchers, community members. And so you may have to do data dissemination multi-scale, where broadcast or multicast or unicast, and different technologies like email, SMS, mobile app and social media need to be used. And for all these things, early warning, we use social media mining and multi-hazard tracking mobile application. Real-time disaster management from rescue to relief, we had actually operated 24-hour call center and an Amrit Kripa mobile application. So here, this is one of the application which we have used, a mobile application which we have used for the Kerala floods 2018 to locate each and every victim and then save them and also provide relief and rescue operations. And the students, more than 500 students continuously for 24 hours, they have worked in the call center to provide this. Now to move into the multi-hazards and also to the landslides, through the landslip program, we have also built a landslide tracker with Amrita and its partners in the landslide, where we are able to collect the data of landslide the moment it happens. So we actually equip the citizens or empower the citizens to give us the details, which can be used tomorrow to develop the thresholds, because most of the time when you work, you have the data, but you don't have the events. So this will help you to capture the events. This will also help you to capture the events which is happening as an early warning, like there is a crack or there is something else you are seeing. They will be able to report, and that information in real time can reach. So there is that work is so for the tracking of landslides. If you see that we have multiple levels of people who will be inputting the data about landslide events, mapping the landslide events, tracking events, summarization and adaptive dissemination. So we have actually looking into the training of landslide mobile app and its awareness. We give the input into it, the time, event and the location, which will give you the spatial temporal landslide events, which is now extended as a multi-hazard application. And it takes, this is the mobile application which is available in Google as an open source thing. Anybody can use as it. It's called Landslide Tracker. And we also have used social media techniques, where Twitter and the other social media and online news have been used to collect the data of disasters. And it has multiple data collection processing, where data sources comes from Twitter, automatic Google search and web scrapers. From there, the data will be analyzed, event is detected, and then based on that visualization dashboard. So in the data, we will classify it. We use machine learning algorithms. Also, the data if from multiple language, like transition and transliteration is also done with getting the feature set to get into the event and then give it. And that is used for the early warning of the system. So in summary, if you think we were building a community resilience as an integrated approach, where we use site-specific sensor data, meteorological dynamics, landscape dynamics, crowdsourcing data from text messages, voice calls, multimedia. And then there is an event detection framework which classify all these things and develop models like adaptive learning models, threshold development, event detection, and then do the alert dissemination at multi-scale as you have earlier seen. And we don't stop with that. We go to the field, work with the community, give them capacity building workshops and training programs, not only to the community. You can see the police force, everybody else we are giving the training to take forward the decision. So as a case study, to scale it, you have to capture the multi-hazard event. You have to measure, monitor, and discover knowledge of multiple sites, multiple triggers, and multiple events. So for that, we have built the IoT framework for this, which has edge layers, fog nodes, fog layer, and application, which has integrated data collection, communication, and also data analysis options, which will take care of all the different applications which we need to have. And the best part is it is a plug and play system to monitor multiple scales from sense. And if you see these layers, it has multiple layers which actually collect the data through sensing layer, acquire it through data acquisition, communicate it, the network, all the different sensors, And the information layer will do the spatio-temporal variation, temporal variation. And the decision layer will do the forecasting and slope stability, adaptive learning. And then the service layer will provide the risk warning. And you can see that it can be from one soil layer to multiple sites it will go. And we also know that to take care of the uncertainty, we assess the uncertainty in hydrology, and it is important to communicate the uncertainty to the people. So systems and solutions require to continuously enhance reliability through multi-parameter sensing and knowledge discovery to handle now connectivity loss. You have used now casting, then multi-scale model, local to regional, and disaster preparedness through forecast models and reduced false alarms. All these things says that for any disaster risk reduction, you have multi-scale nets, you need to have multi-pronged approach, transdisciplinary capabilities, and community empowerment. And we have achieved it through by integrating vulnerability mapping, meteorological, geological, hydrological analysis, real-time monitoring, multi-scale decision models and early warning, and community resilience program. So what we feel is community disaster resilience is paramount important. Multi-phase, multi-scale integrated approach is needed. Deployment of systems and solutions for adaptive and integrated community resilience is required. So all the different technologies like sensing, GIS, IoT, etc. is needed. Integrated approach, edge computing, and multi-scale decision models has to become capturing dynamic changes, validating, reducing false alarm and automation, and integrating community resilience. So we have several international collaborators who work with us, and I thank each one of us, them to working with us and making this as a successful taking forward. This is University of Trento. Earlier one you have seen with BGS and Italian National Council, and we're to you Munich. All this we work with each one of them, and I would say thank you to each one of you.
Thank you very much, ma'am. That was a very comprehensive presentation covering so many aspects end to end in terms of understanding multi-hazards and how to sort of develop everything ranging from predicting to the management once an event happens. So it was very, very comprehensive presentation. There are a few questions that have come up. Can a real-time reservoir operation for flood control using artificial intelligence technique be possible, I suppose? And which sensor and forecast models help to prevent the flood? This is a question that has come up.
I hope I am audible.
Yes.
So for the real-time reservoir operations, there are different sensors which you look into. One is to understand the storage capacity and real-time how the storage is increasing, where you can use pore pressure sensors, water level sensors. You can also look into the flow parameters based on how you are opening each of the valve. So combining all those things, you will be able to get the reservoir operation. But you need to have the model for the flood prediction model, which will tell us how is this going to actually affect or impact each of the low-lying land where this, once you open the dam, will happen. And that is where over the years you will have data, and that will help you to forecast also. So you are not preventing a flood. You are actually, what is happening is you are trying to inform people and the people and also officials take charge of the situation. They get the information ahead of time so that we can save lives. So we move away from that place. That's what we are trying to do, isn't it? We can, like, natural hazards will happen, but can we ahead of time see it and just do the action required? So there is no prevention, but basically to come to us, how do we build in that resilience in the community so that community can be prepared and move away and save. So it will need simulation models, it will need real-time sensors and the combined effect. And over the years, all the sensor data and modeling data will be combined to learn, which will give you the artificial intelligence techniques will be used to learn, and then the decision models will come.
Yeah, so it is not necessarily preventing the event itself, but to sort of be aware of what is likely to happen and then prepare ourselves and go forward. That is a very, very good. So now, how can we prevent flooding in urban areas? That's another question that has been asked.
So for the urban areas, the major thing is there are a lot of new settlements or new urban areas have popped up over the years. So what happened is, like if you take the case of Ernakulam itself, it is a low-lying land with a lot of small ponds, surface things, etc. So once we made it to an urban area, everything got closed, all the drainage got blocked. All this have contributed to the flood. So naturally, you need to look into how we can bring in proper drainage system, which will take care of this flood up to a level where it won't be like so huge impact on us. The second thing what you feel is like, as I earlier said, the moment you have an information ahead of time, there is going to be a flood coming in, you can actually initiate mitigative measures so that you can be out of that area, or you can be like different structures can be built in, etc. Because nowadays our models or capabilities are so high that we are able to find out the extreme weathers ahead of time up to 4 kilometer area. So we could use that and then come up with the difference. So, but all this needs is integration of different disciplines. We need to discuss each other to come up these together. Otherwise, we are standing as different silos and we will never achieve what we need to achieve as community resilience.
True, true. On that important note, thank you very much for the wonderful presentation. And thank you, ma'am. So we move to the next presentation by Dr. Soundarajan, Associate Professor, Department of Civil Engineering from the